So in this chapter, we're going to give a little bit of a proof on how trade can make everyone better off. So we're going to look at the gains from trade. And the principle in chapter one was principle five, which said trade can make everyone better off. And that included trade between individuals. It included trade between states, trade between nations. But there really wasn't a proof of how this could happen, right? How does the trade actually make both parties better off? So in this chapter, we're going to show the proof of how both parties can be better off through trade. So we're going to introduce the first trade concept here, which is referred to as absolute advantage. And absolute advantage is a pretty intuitive concept. Absolute advantage in trade means you're able to produce a good using fewer inputs than another producer. So if you look at this example, you have a Japanese car factory that takes 10 hours to make a car, in an American car factory that takes 12 hours to make a car. So if time's a component to make cars or an input to make cars, then obviously the Japanese factory uses less time, therefore has an absolute advantage when it comes to producing cars. So this is a pretty simple idea, and it can be applied to different items, like, you know, maybe the production of oil. Maybe a certain country has really plentiful oil, natural resources. It's easy for them to get it out of the ground. So they have an absolute advantage at producing oil because it's so easy to basically refine and bring to market. So this is like the most basic trade idea. And it's kind of like that if you're good at something, you should do it, right? If you're good at, I don't know, math, you should be a math major, okay? If you're good at flipping burgers, then that's what your career should be. Well, absolute advantage, which was developed by Adam Smith, kind of is incomplete because it doesn't consider people's other options. You know, what else can they do? So, for example, looking at the Japanese car factory, we don't know what else the Japanese can produce in this example. And absolute advantage doesn't take that into consideration. Maybe, for example, they can produce electronics instead of cars. We don't know what the other options are for the Americans either, right? It doesn't explore that. So the idea of absolute advantage, though important, is somewhat incomplete when it comes to trade. So an economist after Adam Smith named David Ricardo studied Smith and came up with a new trade theory. And the new trade theory that he came up with includes your opportunity cost, right? What else you could be doing. So this is probably the more relevant trade concept, and this is why people specialize in certain fields or why nations specialize in certain production, because they have a comparative advantage in that area. So let's look at the trade concept of comparative advantage. The trade concept of comparative advantage says you have an advantage in producing an item if you have a lower opportunity cost. So you give up less than someone else to produce it. Having a comparative advantage means that you are not necessarily the best at doing something, but you're giving up less. So because it costs you less, the idea is that you're going to be able to do it at a lower price than someone else, and that's your advantage, right? Lower cost equals lower price. And people will really specialize in what they have a comparative advantage in, not necessarily an absolute advantage. So this is an interesting idea, right, that you should specialize and nations should specialize, not necessarily what they're the best at producing, which would be an absolute advantage, but what costs them less to produce, where they have a lower opportunity cost. So one quick example of this, which would tease this out, is you have a skilled brain surgeon. Now, it doesn't necessarily say the best brain surgeon in the world, but a skilled brain surgeon, but that individual is the fastest typist in the world. So this individual types faster than anyone else. So she has an absolute advantage in typing notes. Does that mean she should specialize as a typist? You would say, oh, well, that's absurd, right? Why would the person be a typist? Well, you know, obviously, they would choose to be a brain surgeon instead of being a typist. So think about that. If they chose to be a typist, their opportunity cost would be really, really high. Right? Because for this individual, she would be giving up doing a brain surgery and all the money that would come along with being a brain surgeon. So for her, her opportunity cost is way too high to be a typist. Think about the person that they're going to hire to be a typist. Right? She's not going to type her own note. She's going to hire someone to be a typist. Is that person going to have the option to be a brain surgeon? Are they going to be giving up that kind of work? No, they're going to be giving up less. They're going to be giving up, let's say, maybe working at a school as a secretary. So for that other person that ends up getting hired, their opportunity cost to type notes is less. They're not giving up brain surgery. They're maybe giving up working at a school instead. So that's the person's advantage. And that person would then specialize as a secretary. So we'll look at this with another example, and hopefully it'll help tease it out a little bit more. Yeah.